Hi everyone, in this series we're going to be creating neural networks on the ground up using Python. This series is for anyone who's interested in deep learning, has a rough idea of how things work and wants to actually create a neural network themselves. The end goal of the series is to be able to create a program in Python that will be able to recognize handwritten digits. So for this series I'm expecting you to have a basic understanding of linear algebra and calculus. And I'll have some resources in the description of each video, as well as the code used in the tutorials. If you need help, feel free to drop a comment down below. I'll be replying to all of them. And yeah, this first video will be an introduction, getting you familiar with some of the basic maths needed to get started. And there'll be some light programming towards the end. We'll start off with the basic building block of a neural network, a single neuron. An artificial neuron has something we call a activation, which is governed by its inputs, weights, and biases. To find this activation, we take the weighted sum of all the inputs. This activation can represent many things, like whether a flower is an iris or a rose, as you'll come to see in just a moment. The weights can be thought of as how much influence an input has in the final output or decision. And we also have something called a bias, which again, you'll come to see in just a moment. When we have a dataset that is linearly separable, such as the one you can see on the screen right now, we can use a single neuron to learn to classify the data into two groups. I won't cover specifically how the learning process works just yet. We'll get to that in parts 3 and 4 of this series. So this dataset has two variables. Petal width, which we call x1, and petal length, which we call x2. We want to find a function that will be able to draw a definitive line, which we call a classification boundary, that separates the roses, red flowers, from the irises, blue flowers. To do this, we'll take the weighted sum of our inputs, x1 and x2, and then plot a graph of x1 against x2. And that will give us a straight line, whose weights we can adjust to draw a boundary separating the irises and the roses. As you can see, it would be difficult to draw this boundary without adjusting the y-intercept, so we'll now add in our bias. We decide that we want to draw the line where the activation is 0.5, so if it is higher, it's an iris, and if it's lower, it's a rose. Now using this equation and adjusting the weights and bias by hand, you can see that it would be possible with the right weights and biases to separate the data into categories with just a straight line. And once you've done this, any new data that falls into the blue area will be predicted to be an iris, and any new data that falls into the red area will be predicted to be a rose. But what about when we have data that isn't linearly separable? As you can see for this data on screen, we will not be able to obtain a good result using a single straight line. We'll have to use something called an activation function. This will allow us to establish a classification boundary that is in some shape other than a straight line. Here, we're using the sigmoid function. We'll get into the details of it in just a moment. But as you can see, if we let this dead response program run, we will approach a much better fit than we could achieve with a straight line. From now on, we will define the activation of our neuron as f of z, where z is now the weighted sum of our inputs plus our bias, and f of x is our chosen activation function. There are two quite popular activation functions. The first that you'd want to know about is sigmoid. And then we have another function, which we call the ReLU function, which is short for rectified linear unit function. So if we now come to the graphs, we can see that for the sigmoid function, When you have a low input, you get an output that is close to zero. And when you have high inputs, you get an output close to one. Now, if we look at the ReLU graph, for values less than zero, we get an output of zero. And for values above zero, we get a linear output. For more complex networks, taking the sum of all the inputs is going to be a long and tedious process, so we can instead use linear algebra. Our inputs can be represented by an n-dimensional vector, n being the number of inputs into the neuron. Our biases can then be represented by an m-dimensional vector, m being the number of neurons in the output layer, which in this case is 1. Our weights then make up an m by n matrix, which in this case is a 1 by 2. From this we can then form our linear equation, taking f of z to be z this time to make things a bit simpler. This is what we get. We can take this linear equation and put it in matrix form, and then multiply the matrix out. And this is the equation that we get. As you can see, it's the same as the one we took before. Now we'll look at an actual neural network, which is more of what we'll be dealing with in the future, and we'll consider just the first and second layers. As you can see, our input is still a two-dimensional vector, but now our bias vector has two dimensions because we have three neurons on the second layer, and our weight matrix forms a 3x2 matrix because we have two inputs on our input layer and three outputs on our output layer. And we'll take the activation function this time. And now if we take our equation and put it in matrix form, this is what we get. We can now multiply it out, and we are left with a three-dimensional vector for our activations. We can also apply our activation function, and we just do this by applying it to each component of that vector. Hopefully now you can start to see the benefits of doing this using vectors and matrices, as opposed to writing separate sums for each neuron. Now we'll look at the last or second layer, and we can apply the same principles. Our weight matrix is now a 1x3, because we have one output, three inputs. We can then write this as our equation, put it in matrix form, multiply out, and this is the result we get. Now we'll dive into some programming. First, we'll import a module called numpy as np. If you don't have this installed, you're going to want to get that installed. We'll define our activation function as f of x, and we'll return the sigmoid function, which we saw earlier. Now I'm just writing out a matrix for our weights. And then next we'll do biases. And then following, we'll do our inputs. Okay, so now I'll go ahead and print out our matrix multiplication. To multiply two matrices using numpy, you just use np.matmul and then put in the two things you want to multiply. Alright, so I'll go ahead and print this or run this program now. And as you can see, we get 3. And then we'll go ahead and add our bias, and that should give us the number 4, which it does. And if you're still confused about this, I'll show you something on screen now to explain. So this is how we are getting 3 and 4. Okay, next I'll just apply the activation function. So that just involves wrapping that linear part we had in F, like so. And then you see we get a value very close to 1, which is to be expected. Okay, let's change things up a bit. I'm going to remove the F and I'm going to change our weights, biases and inputs to reflect a different shape. We'll go for a 3x2 matrix this time for our weights. Then our biases just need to be a 3-dimensional vector. And then for our inputs, we just need a 2-dimensional vector, which we already have. And we'll run this. Got to add in extra brackets. And you can see we get 3. I'll have something on the side explaining why we get 3, in case you're confused. Okay, now we're nearing the end. I'll just take the activation function again. And then we get a load of outputs close to 1 again. So that's the end of the video. I hope you guys have enjoyed. Part 2, we'll be doing a lot more programming. And that will be out soon. And yeah, again, if you're stuck, need help, make sure to comment down in the comment section below. And thank you for watching.